Today we're going to look at King David. Last week we looked at young David. And this week we're going to look at King David. But as always, I'm going to have to cover a lot of stuff. But I hope this is useful. I don't know. I was thinking this is kind of like a Sunday school for grown-ups. You know, we're like just going over the whole storyline, but we're doing it kind of real fast. All right, let me just back up and remind you of some of where we've been. After the Philistines defeated Israel, Israel called and insisted on having a king. And the first Israelite king, King Saul, he was anointed by the prophet Samuel around 1051 BC. David was born in Bethlehem around 1041 BC. So this is after Saul had been ruling for about 10 years. And Saul, you will remember, he was disobedient to God, and the result was that both his dynasty and his kingship were taken from him. And when David was probably 12 to 14 years old, that's a good estimate, around 1028 BC, he was anointed as the next king by the prophet Samuel. And though Saul continued as king, the de facto king, for a number of years, till he was removed by God around 1011 BC, Saul's total reign being 40 years, as you see in Acts chapter 13, verse 21. After defeating Goliath, when he was still a young man, I was estimating maybe 15 to 19, something like that, when he was still young, David was again brought into Saul's court. You remember he had earlier been in Saul's court as a musical therapist for these problems that the Spirit was bringing on him. Saul became jealous of David's popularity and he sought to kill him. And that then produced for David, he spent years on the run. And then Saul and several of his sons, they died on Mount Gilboa around 1011 BC. And they died in a losing battle with the Philistines. And then shortly thereafter, David was anointed at Hebron, king over the territory of Judah. So Saul and his sons die at 1011. David is anointed at Hebron as king over the house of Judah. And Hebron, that was the chief city, or one of the chief cities of Judah at that time. And this is reported in 2 Samuel chapter 2, and that's where I want to pick back up with the story. Now, the fact that Judah yes, no? I'm going to do this really, there we go. We're going to do this really remotely. I'm going to do it up here. I'm going to yell to you, and then you're going to change the slide. All right, the fact Judah independently acclaimed David king isn't surprising. I mean, David is a Judean. He's born in Bethlehem, and he treated Judah quite well during the time of his fleeing in exile. And so you remember that he had given them distributed things. He'd protected the border and this kind of thing. So it's not surprising that Judah comes and receives David as king. And that action of David being king gradually gains support from other places and other people. And we'll see that. Now, initially, the other tribes, the northern tribes, they're opposed to David as king over them. And about 5 years after David had been king just over the southern territory of Judah, about 5 years after that, Saul's cousin, okay, Saul's now dead, the first king, but his cousin Abner, who'd been his chief military officer, Abner's a warrior. Well, Saul's cousin Abner, he appoints as king of the northern tribes Saul's youngest son, Ishbosheth. So you had this time, David's at Hebron for a number of years, and then Abner, who was Saul's military commander, he says, takes this son who's the descendant of Saul, and he says, you're going to be king of the northern tribes here. So these tribes, by the way, they came to be referred to as Israel in distinction from Judah. Okay, that's what happens, is you see this division here, and it comes in time that the group of northern tribes get referred to as Israel, and the southern group is called Judah. Now, the tribe of Benjamin eventually becomes part of the southern kingdom of Judah, leaving Israel with 10 tribes in the north and Judah with 2 tribes. But this is just now, this identification as Israel and Judah now is just beginning. But you have Ishbosheth, he's appointed by Abner's hand as the king of these northern tribes. And then Abner, next slide. I don't know what's happened to this thing, but next slide. Por favor. Thank you. Now, Abner and the men who were loyal to Ishbosheth, so remember, Abner has him appointed king of the northern tribe. Well, Abner and the men who are loyal to Ishbosheth and Joab, who's David's chief military officer. All right, Abner was Saul's military officer. He has Ishbosheth appointed king in the north. Well, Abner and those who are loyal to Ishbosheth and Joab, who's David's military officer, and those who are loyal to David, they meet at Gibeon. So, we had Ishbosheth was up in Mahanaim. And then they meet at Gibeon. And from Hebron, here come Joab's people. Now, what are they doing there? Well, perhaps they're meeting to discuss the possibility of a united kingdom. You know, maybe they're trying to say, can this be worked out or something? You know, can we have a discussion of some kind? Well, you know what happens? It ends up in a battle. I mean, you first have the groups are picked, and then these guys kill each other. And then you have this battle that breaks out. And in that battle, Abner killed Joab's brother, Asahel. Okay, that'll come up later. Okay, in this battle, you remember he's being chased and he says, back off, and he's being chased. And he finally, got my tech man on it. But so this is what happens in that battle. Now, the war between the house of Saul and the house of David continued for a year or more. And so you have this battle. And during that time, David grew stronger and the house of Saul grew weaker. Now, what exactly that means, but you see the handwriting's on the wall that David looks like he's going to be the one who is going to triumph. Well, Abner, he sleeps with one of Saul's concubines. Now, that has all kinds of political ramifications and indications and signs when you're doing that. But he sleeps with one of Saul's concubines, and Ishbosheth questions his motives in doing so. Basically accuses him of being disloyal to Ishbosheth and making a move on the kingdom, which he probably was. I mean, why else would he be doing that? But he then takes great umbrage, what do you think, I'm a dog? And I'm going to be disloyal and this kind of thing? So he takes great umbrage about it. And it's interesting to me, by the way, Ishbosheth, you don't get the sense that he's very strong, whereas this guy's a fighter. And it says in there that Ishbosheth, when he made Abner mad, he said, Ishbosheth was afraid of Abner. And I said, indeed, Abner kill you. So anyway, so Abner takes umbrage at this, and he thereafter sent word to David that he would deliver Israel over to him, meaning that he would influence the northern tribes so that they would embrace David's kingship. All right, so David agrees to strike a deal with Abner on the condition, he says, first you got to return my wife Michal. You have to bring her. That's the one that you remember that he earned. You know, the bride price was with the Philistine foreskins. So she had been taken from him, and he says, you got to return my wife Michal, who's Saul's daughter. And see, there's more to this than just David wanting her. That would symbolize, you see, the unification of the two royal families, Saul and David. So he says, Saul's daughter, my wife, needs to be returned to me. Now, after Michal was returned to David, Abner then he persuades the elders of those northern tribes of the wisdom of casting their lot with David. So he was successful, and he says, I can influence them, and I can deliver them to you. So he says, first, give back Michal. So that happens. He then does, in fact, influence the elders of the northern tribes to cast their lot with David. And he met David at Hebron to let him know that the stage had been set for the unification that they'd been talking about. Everything was ready, that what they wanted to do. So they planned to make a formal compact. You see, they were going to have this done in a formal way, and they were going to have a formal coronation of David as king of the unified Israel. That was at least what they intended. But before any of that could be arranged, Joab, who's David's commander, he privately summons Abner back to Hebron. So he'd met with David in Hebron, he's going back, and then Joab summons him privately and brings him back, and he murders him in cold blood because he had killed Joab's brother Asahel in that battle that started at Gibeon. So right on the brink of this unification, he murders this guy. Well, now that obviously has a great potential to generate anger and resentment against David within Israel, right? You can see that. But, I mean, people go crazy saying he goes down there, you wind up killing him off. You murdered this Israelite brother. And so this had great potential, you see, to mess this up and to derail the planned unification, because if people blame David for that, they're not going to go along with the unification. Well, David, he cursed Joab's house. You see, David makes clear to people that this isn't my doing. He cursed Joab's house for what he'd done. He mourned Abner's death. And then he had Abner buried with full state honor. You know, just a big procession and everything to see that, look, I'm bummed about this. This wasn't my doing. I'm distressed about this and I'm mourning over this. And the people were convinced of David's sincerity. You know, they were convinced that this wasn't David's doing, but it was a personal act of vengeance on the part of Joab. Okay, so that had passed. You know, he had gotten by that because that would have destroyed the unification. And then soon after that, Ishbosheth. Okay, remember, so Abner's his commander. He's working against him and he's going to do this deal, deliver over Israel to David. He gets murdered by Joab. But then Ishbosheth, right after that, he's murdered by two captains of his raiding bands. He's murdered while he's taking a nap at his house. They come and they kill him. I tell you, politics was really rough business back then. But they kill Ishbosheth and they cut his head off. And they bring it to David at Hebron. They figure David's going to be happy because here's this guy who's your rival over these other tribes. I've killed him. Now here's his head. And so they thought David would be happy with that. And David told them, in essence, that he killed the man who had claimed to put King Saul out of his misery at Mount Gilboa. You remember when that guy came, that Amalekite came, and he said, hey, yeah, this is what I did. I think like he was probably scavenging the bodies, but he said, this is what I did. David had him killed. So David says, I had him killed. What do you think I'm going to do to you, you evil, wicked people who kill a man in his bed, in his own house? So David orders that they're killed, and they are. He has them put to death, and he has their hands and feet cut off, and their bodies hung up publicly on display. So you can see David is saying to all the world, I find this despicable. I don't care that he killed Ishbosheth. They killed him. I find this despicable behavior. And that's what David is saying with that. And then he had Ishbosheth's head buried in Abner's tomb. All of this, you see, is what? It's helping the people to see that David is not the one doing this stuff. And so then it keeps alive the spirit that we can be unified. Because both of those things were very dangerous for that. And in 2 Samuel chapter 5, God works. 2 Samuel 5, David is anointed at Hebron as king over all of Israel and Judah. Okay, so he had been king over Judah. Now he's anointed as king over all of Israel and Judah. And he soon thereafter, he captured Jerusalem as this capital of the United Kingdom. You see, Hebron wouldn't do as the capital of the United Kingdom because it was too far south and it was too strongly associated with the tribe of Judah. So it wouldn't be a very good capital for the United Kingdom, whereas Jerusalem, it bordered on Judah, and in fact, unlike this little diagram shows, it was technically in the territorial inheritance of Benjamin. I mean, it's right on the border. But it's technically in the territorial inheritance of Benjamin. So it's suitable. It's a more neutral place for David to have as his kingdom. Now, it had been, they had captured at some point. You remember we were looking at Judges. They had captured, or Joshua and Judges. They had captured Jerusalem at some point. Then it must have reverted to the Jebusites. And here David is. He captures it. And David's time of reigning in Hebron was 7.5 years. So his anointing as king of the United Israel occurred around 1004 B.C. Because this is 1011, 7.5 years, were about 1004 B.C. And the Philistines, they'd been willing to tolerate David. When he's reigning in Hebron, just over Judah, they'd been willing to tolerate him. Remember, David had been over there feigning that he was like a traitor and been working with them. And so when they go up in this great battle they're going to go up, which leads to the death of Saul, they send David back. So he'd been kind of allied with them. You know, basically comes and says, listen, I'm at your service. You know, I'm fleeing from, said, I tells them I'm raiding Judah all the time. I can't stand them. So he comes, and when he's made king of Judah, it looks like they're willing to tolerate him. Maybe they see him as a continuing ally, and they think this is still working to our advantage because he's keeping the kingdom divided. But as soon as David becomes king over a united Israel, they attacked him twice in succession, and God gave David the victory over the Philistines on both of those occasions. Now, the Ark of the Covenant had remained at the city of the town of Kiriath-Jearim. It had remained there since being returned by the Philistines in 1 Samuel chapter 6. You remember how they put the thing on the cart and had the cows bring it, and whichever way it goes, winds up going there. So they had returned, they got hold of the ark, and they thought this was going to be great stuff, and the ark was smoking them. So they said, we got to get rid of this thing. Okay, God will defend his ark, and we'll see that again. But it's been in this town now. So at some point, and it's not clear when, it was perhaps decades after conquering Jerusalem, but at some point David constructed buildings for himself in the city, and he had the ark brought to the city, and he placed it in a special tent that he had pitched for it. Now, on the first attempt to bring the ark in, he had it transported on a cart pulled by oxen, which was very similar to the way that the pagan Philistines had transported it. But he had it done that way instead of on poles, as God had commanded. The Levites were to transport all of the holy things. They were first to be covered by the priests, so you wouldn't even see it. This stuff is so holy, you can't even look at it. He covered, and then they were to carry it on poles. And so they weren't doing that. They wind up like the Philistines, and they put it on this ark. And you can see the command that they carry it on poles in Numbers 4:15, Numbers 7:9, 1 Chronicles 15:2, and 12:15 show that that's really the fact they weren't doing that is the root of what happens to Uzzah. Well, that disobedience of carrying it on the cart instead of what God had commanded him to do, that led to God killing Uzzah for physically grabbing the ark and trying to stabilize it. He actually touched it. He touched the ark. Well, God, you know, Uzzah shouldn't have been in that position, but he still should have never touched the ark. He should have never touched it. It is the representation of the absolutely holy God. He shouldn't have touched that. It shouldn't have been on the cart, so he'd be in that position. But he shouldn't have touched it. God had made clear in Numbers chapter 4, verse 15, that any of the Levites who touched the holy things while they were transporting them would die. So this isn't a surprise. He had said that. If you touch any of the holy things when you're transporting them, it's death. Okay, well, he touched one of the holy things when transporting it in a way they shouldn't have been transporting it, and in fact, he was put to death. It was an act of irreverence. That, you know, I think we have trouble with these ideas. What's God care? It's his holiness represented. You see, he's absolutely holy. And so when this is touched, he winds up this act of irreverence, he's killed. You recall in 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 19 and 20, that God struck down 70 men from Beth Shemesh who had the audacity, they thought they could look in the ark, thought it was like a box. And I said, what do you think? I'll just open it up. You see, I go, yeah. Well, he killed 70 of them. It is because what that represents, you see, God is holy, and that has to be known and understood. I just thought of the Raiders of the Lost Ark at the end when they opened that bad boy. All right, whatever you think of that image, that was someone said, no, this thing is powerful. God will vindicate this. All right, David was upset because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Uzzah, it says in 2 Samuel 6, 8. But most likely meaning not that he's upset with God. You see, after all, God is simply doing what God had said he would do in Numbers 4:15. He says, you touch one of the holy things, you're going to die. I don't think he's upset with God. I think he's upset with Uzzah having acted in such a way to cause God to execute judgment. That's what's going on. After all, Isaiah, God was merely enforcing what he had told them. So this is, David is distressed or upset, and some translations say angry. Now, David's heightened fear of the Lord from this event is actually a positive thing. Again, I don't think we like the concept of fear of the Lord, but it's all over the Bible, and it is the beginning of wisdom. And if the leader of a nation doesn't have fear of God, it puts the entire community at risk. When a leader doesn't have adequate reverence, fear of disobeying God and what God will do if we turn from him, well, then that spills out. So ultimately, I think that this is a positive thing. And after a three-month detour, after that happened, the ark was put in the home of Obed-Edom for 3 months. And then David had the ark properly brought into Jerusalem with much celebration and sacrificing of animals. Now, after David had lived in the house that he built for himself in Jerusalem, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies, it says in 2 Samuel 7:1, which suggests there was a significant passage of time, he desired to build a temple to house the Ark of the Covenant. It had been in this tent that he had pitched for the Ark, but now he desired to build a house, a temple, to house the Ark of the Covenant. And God told him that his son Solomon, he says, you know, that's a good idea. And I appreciate that idea and that heart. But he says, your son Solomon would build the temple because during Solomon's reign, the land would have peace from its enemies. You see, unlike during David's reign, which involved wars against many enemies, David was essentially finalizing and securing the conquest. He was coming in and he had to battle a lot of people and secure borders and make the state peaceful. And so he had to do that, you see. So David's reign involved that. And it's not because there was anything wrong with David's wars. Sometimes we get the idea, well, no, David was somehow disqualified because his hands were bloodstained. These were God's wars. These were God's wars, wars that God was fighting on behalf of Israel. David wasn't doing anything wrong in doing this. That's not what's going on here at all. As Tremper Longman says in his book, Making Sense of the Old Testament, he says, David had the role of completing the conquest, and since the temple symbolized peace from enemies, the task was better left to his successor, whose very name, Solomon, meant peace. So that's the idea that's going on. He says, no, your role in what I'm doing was to secure Israel. Now, who will build this temple that represents the stable state there and my people resting in peace here will be your son Solomon. And so that's what I think is happening there. Now, instead of David building God's house, God tells David, 2 Samuel 7, that he'll build him a house. He said, I want to build you a house. He says, no, that's going to be Solomon. He says, but I tell you what, I'll build you a house. You see, he's going to build him a house, meaning he will establish an eternal ruling dynasty of David's descendants. The right to rule will never be taken from David's family as it had been taken from Saul's. You see, Saul was here. He lost the dynasty and the kingship, so that no longer will the chain be your descendants will rule. But he says to David, I'm going to build you a house. Your descendants will always have the right to rule. Rulership will be in the house of David. And that's, I think that's just a critically important thing. Okay? So the right to rule will never be taken. In 2 Samuel 7, then David responds with this great prayer of gratitude in 2 Samuel 7. Now note that God makes clear in 2 Samuel 7 and in Psalm 89, God makes perfectly clear that he will punish David's faithless descendants. The fact that you have the right to rule and I'm not going to take that away from you doesn't mean I'm not going to punish your descendants when they disobey. And you see that happening throughout Israel's history. So there'll be times of exile. People say, I thought somebody's going to be sitting on the right to rule remains. But he will discipline and punish the descendants of David who are faithless. And so he says that specifically in 2 Samuel 7 and Psalm 89. Now, Jesus is, of course, the immortal descendant of David, the son of David. That's why they're always crying out, O son of David. See, he's the immortal descendant of David who's been placed by God permanently on David's throne. He sits on David's throne. You can see that, for example, in Luke chapter 1, verse 29 to 33, Acts chapter 2, 29 to 36, and in other places. So that's why, you know, people ask me, many years ago somebody asked me, what do church of people in the Church of Christ think of Jewish people? I said, well, I serve a Jewish Lord. My Lord sits on David's throne. You see? And so that is what's going on. So this promise to David in 2 Samuel 7 that one of his descendants, well, Jesus is the ultimate son of David, the quintessential son of David, who sits permanently on the throne of David. All right, now 2 Samuel chapter 8 and 10. I don't know if I'm going to make it. We'll see. All right, 2 Samuel chapter 8 and 10, they report David's military victories over Moab, over Hadadezer, king of Zobah, over Edom, over Hanun, king of Ammon. You see this in Syria. And then chapter 12 reports the capture of Reba, the royal city of the Ammonites. So David here is just bad news when it comes to a military guy. Of course, God is working through David. But David goes and he has these conquests and these military victories. And here's David's kingdom, the pink area there, when it's all said and done. This is the kingdom and the area, and you see, I don't know if you can read this little thing, but it says here, tributary to David. Those are the green areas that paid tribute to David. And the other areas are the kingdom of United Kingdom of Israel. And so David goes out and he takes care of these and does these things. Now in 2 Samuel chapter 9, there's this story of David's kindness to Jonathan's crippled son, Mephibosheth. And you see the story of his being crippled in 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. Now, there's a dynamite sermon that a guy named Donald Sanukjian created that I've lifted from him and preached on two occasions about Mephibosheth. And I did it just because I loved it so much. But anyway, those who've heard it, I like that sermon a lot about Dave, how David treats this person and brings him in. But in 2 Samuel, so that's in 2 Samuel 9. Now, Bathsheba. She's, of course, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Bathsheba's the wife of Uriah the Hittite, and David commits adultery with her, as reported in 2 Samuel chapter 11. You know, he looks out there and sees her. Now, David's got all these women. But you know how it is, dudes. He got all these women. What's he got to do? He's looking around somewhere else. Okay, he sees this woman, and lust begins, and it's downhill from there, I'm telling you. Downhill. He commits adultery with her. Well, now he's in a tough spot. He tries to cover that up. You see, man, this is no good. So what if she's pregnant? I know what I'll do. I'll get Uriah to come back from the battlefield. He'll go in and sleep with his wife. And then if she is pregnant, it'll be his kid. Nobody will be the wiser. So he brings Uriah back from the battlefield. And Uriah says, basically, no dice. I'm not going to do that. You think I'm going to go in and sleep with my wife when my fellow soldiers are out suffering in the field? What kind of a person would I be to do that? Ooh. Ooh. David, so here's David exposed again in trying to do this stuff. So when that doesn't work, you see, he then has Uriah killed in battle. Has, in fact, Uriah carry the plans that are going to lead to his death. He says, you go ahead and you put this dude up front and you back away from him and the enemy will kill him. You see, the enemy will wind up killing him. And that's, in fact, what happens. And I just see the power of lust there, what it has done. What it has done. Unrestrained, uncontrolled, undisciplined. And look what it led to in this very great man of faith. As you can imagine, David's conduct involving Bathsheba greatly displeased the Lord. Right? You can imagine that, right? Greatly displeased the Lord, as the prophet Nathan made clear to him in 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verses 10 and 11 says, now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Because that's what happened after David had him killed. He then took Bathsheba to be his wife. So this is God speaking to him through Nathan. He says, thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. It's going to be public. I'm going to give your wives to somebody publicly. It's going to be seen they go in and sleep with your wives. All right, that sounds pretty heavy. But this is, where did this come from? It came from that fall and that lusting that happened. He told David in verse 14 that the child born to him by Bathsheba would die, and the happening of that's reported in verse 18. Now, in keeping with Nathan's prophecy, things from that point, they turn tragic in the life of David and his family. 2 Samuel 13, David's oldest son Amnon rapes his half-sister Tamar. Lust. Lust. What had gotten David? He saw her and said, ooh, I got to have her. And when the king says, I got to have her, you know, the king can get her. Was it right? No. Moral? Wrong. What happened? Lust. He let it run crazy. Okay, what happens to this guy? He's lusting after his half-sister Tamar, and he winds up raping her. 2 years later, David's third son, Absalom, killed Amnon in revenge for that rape. Absalom then flees to a region here called Geshur. He then flees after having done that to this region. And after he'd been there 3 years, David was longing for him. David was missing him because the pain of Amnon's death had now, you know, grown dimmer. He was grieving Amnon, and now he's just longing for Absalom, who's been away for years. 2 Samuel chapter 14, Joab uses a woman from Tekoa to persuade David to allow Absalom to return to Jerusalem. He persuades him to do that. And so David grants that request, but he doesn't allow Absalom to come into his presence for 2 years. And when he finally permitted it, again, Joab presents that request to David. When David finally permits it, Absalom bows before David. David kisses him. You think, okay, everything's really good. But Absalom uses his acceptance in Jerusalem. He uses that acceptance to steal the people's hearts. You see, he's at the gate saying, oh, no, you got a great case. That's all right. You know, he's out there schmoozing big time and holding himself up as I'm really the guy. I'm a wonderful guy. Great. Oh, well, man, Absalom. You got to love that guy, Absalom. He's really great. You see, and this is what he's doing. He uses this to steal the people's hearts. And after 4 years, he was ready to make a move on the throne. He felt he had sufficiently ingratiated himself to the people that it was now time he thinks he can pull it off. He thinks he can make a move on the throne. So he goes to Hebron, which is not coincidental. Under a ruse, he goes to Hebron, and he sent out messengers all from there announcing his intentions. It's going down. He's telling everybody, okay, he sends them out, obviously not the people who would come and jump him yet, but he sends the word out that it's going down, and its conspiracy grows stronger. And when David's told that the people had gone over to Absalom, when he's told that, well, then they take off, because David knows that Absalom and his army are going to come and kill him. This is how this stuff worked. When your successor came to the throne, he didn't leave you around to keep stirring people up and saying, hey, we ought to really be following David. You were toast. So when they said, look, Absalom, he's got, you know, this is it. He's got the people. David says, okay, we got to go. And so he flees. David flees. David and those who are loyal to him. And he flees. And then Absalom enters Jerusalem, and as prophesied, he went into David's concubines slash wives in the sight of all of Israel. Pitched a tent for him so everybody could see, look, he's going in. He's sticking his finger in David's eye. And part of that was to strengthen the hands of those who followed him, because they said, okay, there's no turning back now. You see, when he did that, he's not going to wind up something and kind of punk out on us and go say, David, can we kind of work something out? No. Okay, so that's what it says when it means that doing that strengthens the hand of those who are following, because they say, okay, we're in. We're in, and that's what's going on now. You remember Ahithophel? Ahithophel is somebody who's renowned for his counsel. And he comes in and he's telling, look, you need to go after David right away. Right away. Go get him. Go get him. Okay, well, David's inside man, Hushai the Archite, he comes in and he says, you know, the guy's really always good, but I think he's wrong this time. You need to sit tight for a minute. And okay, all right, well, that allows David's people to escape. And they wind up having a battle. Absalom's army, they engage with David's men in this fierce battle in the forest of Ephraim, and David's men defeat them. And despite David being told by David to deal gently with Absalom, it's because it's his son. It's his son who's doing this to him, but he still tells the man in this battle, you deal gently with Absalom, will you? Well, Joab says, you got to be crazy. So this is when Absalom's hung up in the tree, whether his hair's caught or his head's wedged in something like that. He kills him. So he kills Absalom, okay? And instead of celebrating the victory that spared David's kingship, David's weeping and mourning over his son. So you can see that when your army goes out and fights for you and risks their lives and does all this stuff, they come back with a victory over the person who's trying to depose you. You come back and what are you doing? Oh, Absalom, Absalom. Well, what do you think these guys feel like? See, normally when we go out and win a victory, it's a party, it's a celebration. You're held up in esteem, as we try to do with soldiers. We don't always make it. But people who go and fight and risk their lives or do honor. So he's doing this. Well, Joab rebuked him and he says he loved those who hated him and hated those who loved him. And he told David, he said, look, you would have preferred that if Absalom had remained alive and all of us had been dead. Obviously, that's how you feel because we're the victors and all you can think about is how terrible that your son who's trying to take your kingdom's killed. So he says, look, you know, this is like crazy. And he also says, listen, if you don't snap out of it, those who fought for you are going to abandon you. Nobody's going to put up with this. Nobody's going to put up with going risk their lives for you and then have you treat them with dishonor like what they've done for you is not something noble and right and good. And he said, and if they do abandon you, that's going to be the worst thing yet. So David takes that. You see that Joab's not afraid to speak, by the way. But David takes that and he goes and sits at the gate of Mahanaim to welcome the victorious soldiers. Now, after some statesmanship, he's there. He's won the victory. He has some statesmanship where he promises, includes this promise. There are some other things, but he includes this promise to replace Joab with Amasa as going to be his chief military officer. Amasa was Absalom's military commander. You would think, why would you replace him with somebody who lost? Well, this is politics. You see, so he was doing this. He says he's going to replace him. And then the people were then, they were persuaded to resume their loyalty to David. So they all turned out to meet David as he's on his way back to Jerusalem. There's some neat stories in here that I got to skip over about the guy who's cursing David and all that. When David's going out and when David comes back, it's kind of a different story. He's like going, oh man, I was yelling at him and throwing rocks at him. Okay, but we can't talk about that. So you have them turn out, but bickering breaks out between the people of Israel and Judah. You have this bickering breaks out, and a man named Sheba, he prompts a good number of the men of Israel, which is hyperbolically referred to as all the men of Israel, but he gets a good number of the men of Israel to withdraw from David, but David continues on down to Jerusalem. And when David gets to Jerusalem, he told Amasa, who's now, you know, he's the new acting commander, he tells Amasa, look, you go out there and you gather the men of Judah, you go out there and you bring them to me within 3 days. Well, he didn't make the deadline. He said 3 days and he wasn't there. So he says, okay. So David then called on Abishai, which is Joab's brother. And therefore that would involve Joab. So he calls on Abishai, which meant his brother Joab as well. He says, you guys go hunt down Sheba. Because he's concerned that this guy Sheba, who's now pulling away people, he says it's going to be, you know, worse than what we had with Absalom. So he says, you go hunt him down. So they go out there to hunt him down. And they're on their way to do that. Let's see if I can get this thing right. So they go up to hunt down Sheba, and by the way, Amasa joins them. He meets them up. See, he'd been out there gathering people 3 days, didn't make it in time. He meets them. Well, Joab kills him. Now, Joab kills him, no doubt, because he's a rival. Joab says, "You think you're going to take my gig?" He kills him. But they then continue on in pursuit of Sheba, and they go up to Abel of Beth-Maacah. And they go up there, and that's where he tells us, you know, they're going to besiege the city. And this woman comes out, and he says, "Hey, what's up?" And he says, "Look, we got no beef with the city. We're just after this guy. He's a rebel, and we want him." He says, "Tell you what, you throw his head over the wall, and we'll leave the city alone." All right, here comes the head. Head comes over the wall. All right, so that's what happens to this guy. Now, chapter 24 begins with the statement of that God's anger was again kindled against Israel. Now, the reason isn't it said, but it's presumably some kind of disobedience of the law of God. Now, rather than punish the nation directly for whatever disobedience that was, God allows an adversary. Okay, now whether that's Satan himself or whether it's a general adversary, it's typically translated Satan in 1 Chronicles 21:1. But he allows an adversary to tempt David, the representative of the nation, into sinning by conducting a census of the fighting men of Israel. Now, David's clearly culpable in the matter. There's no question about that. He's enticed or he's tempted to do this, whether it be by a general adversary, a bordering neighbor that's threatening him, or whether it's the adversary, whether it's Satan himself. David's culpable as he repents when he's convicted of the offense. You see that he says in 24:10, "I have sinned greatly in what I have done." Okay, I've sinned greatly. So David repents and he's convicted of that. Now, it's not clear what's wrong with taking a census. That's just one of these things. You know, what is it? Maybe he did it for purposes of boasting, or maybe he did it because he was going to rely on the military for safety rather than God, or maybe he failed to have the enrolled males pay the half shekel ransom that's required by the law in Exodus chapter 30, verse 13 to 16. In any event, he's done something wrong, he repents, and the Lord gives him a choice of the punishments, and David chose 3 days of pestilence, and 70,000 Israelites died as a result. 70,000 Israelites, and the plague, it stops at the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. And David then buys that property, he erects an altar, he made sacrifices to God, and the temple would later be built on that spot where he does that. Now, in the reconstructing the events at the end of David's life, it seems that David's son Solomon was made co-regent with David around 973. If you look in 1 Chronicles chapter 23, verse 1, this was the time when he was charging Solomon with regard to the building of the temple, a project that David had made great preparation for. So when he's charging there, it seems that he appoints Solomon as co-regent. David is now very old. He appoints him as co-regent, and that appointment didn't sit well with Solomon's older brother, Adonijah. Adonijah is the one that David spoiled. You know, it says in 1 Kings 1:6 that, you know, he never, I forget the phrasing, but he never did anything to upset the guy or correct him or that kind of thing. So this didn't sit well with Adonijah, who around 971 BC, he conspired with others to usurp the throne of Solomon. So David's already given the nod to Solomon. And he said, here, he's a co-regent ruling with David. And so Adonijah, after about 2 years, he says, "Listen, David's getting ready to die. I don't like this idea." So he tries to usurp the throne from Solomon so that when David dies, Solomon doesn't carry on, he does. Okay, that's what he's trying to do. Well, Nathan informs Solomon's mother, Bathsheba, that Adonijah is trying to steal the throne. This is all in 1 Kings chapter 1 and 2. But he tells him, look, Adonijah is trying to steal the throne. And then both of them, Nathan and Bathsheba, they move David to action. They go there and they convince David to act, to arrange for Solomon to be brought before the people so that his prior, heard that bell, so that his prior appointment that he'd made of Solomon might be ratified in this formal public coronation. Okay, so he's already been appointed, but this now this usurping is going on. So he has this plan. Solomon's going to be appointed now with this formal public coronation. And that's why almost through, that's why 1 Chronicles 29, the second part of verse 22, it refers to Solomon being acknowledged as king a second time. You see, well, what's that about? Well, that's what I'm telling you. You see, he's co-regent, and then when this thing right near the end of David's dying, Adonijah's wrestling for the throne, David has this public coronation to make clear to everybody, when I'm gone, it's Solomon. Okay, so this is what it's about a second time. Then David dies shortly thereafter in 971 BC, having reigned for 40 years. And then next week, Lord willing, we'll carry on with the story of Solomon. Thanks.